I would like to give you my testimony.
Wow.
And I would like to talk about the subject of faith. When I learned first in the Pastor John's class, I had misunderstood faith in something that is, in some cases, very similar to faith, and that is being in agreement. That was something that it took me about 6 months, I would say, of intensive reading and understanding what the difference was to me. And so I would recommend to you, because I felt, before I was a Christian, I felt I was a person with strong faith. I remember one particular case. We were losing a game that we were odds on favorite to win. And on the sideline, we started the game wrong, the attitude, everything was, and they started with a lot of positive things, and they were slowly climbing up seventh heaven, and it takes time to knock it back down again. And I heard two of my teammates saying, "Oh my God, tomorrow in the newspaper is going to say the favorites lost the game." And I turned around and grabbed him and said, "We are not losing this game." Because my mentality refused that I would lose the game. So that is faith in my own abilities, or in my teammates, or in our preparation and what we had done. And they looked at me and they said, "Yes, you're right." So they were immediately a change of mind and in agreement with me. They believed that we are not going to lose this game. So many times in my life, I felt that I was in agreement with somebody, with something, and I was in agreement that there's a God that exists. Maybe don't know how it is, in which form, or I felt that I had a different kind of communication with him. Yeah? It was when it suited me, I would talk to him, I would ask him to help me, and forget about all the times that I felt I didn't need help or something. So I think it's a very, very important and a distinctive difference between believing or being in agreement with something than having faith. And once researching, reading, talking to pastors and talking to people, I started to feel a difference in faith, true faith, yeah, and what we very often also do as human beings, and I count myself in there, is we pretend to have faith in something. We want to show to others and to the outside that we have the doubts. While we speak it, we already have doubts. Yeah? So when you see something like this, it shows you very clearly that it just doesn't work. And like Pastor John just said, it's also very, very easy. I can lie to each and every one of you, but I can never lie to myself. It just doesn't work. The second I use a wrong word or say something that is untrue, I already know that I'm saying a lie. Yeah? So if I stand in front of you, and I have as a head coach, as a professional head coach, I stand, and I was very famous for my motivational talks. Yeah? I could get the whole room shaking and they were ready to go out and kill. Because everything about me believed what I was saying. So I forced you to believe what I'm saying or being in agreement with me. And this is something totally different. And I would really encourage you, like Pastor John said, to study and see and ask yourself, how many times have I had faith or have I been in agreement with something? Because to me, there's a big, big difference. Mm-hmm. Yeah? If somebody says, I don't know, this is going to happen, and you think, well, under these circumstances, that's possible. Yeah? So you are in agreement that this may happen. Yeah? But if somebody says, have faith and your cancer will go away, well, I don't think without chemotherapy, or I don't think without the best doctors, or without money or everything like that. So you may not necessarily agree with it, but you have heard of stories or testimonies from fellow brothers and sisters where they said, I woke up and it's gone. They couldn't even find it. I heard a testimony from a pastor. It was amazing. He had a part of the liver missing. And he actually has x-rays. And he goes back almost 2 years later, and he has the whole liver.
Amen. Wow.
So, you know, I mean, there's no doctor that can explain what that is. And he says, that was my faith. I pray for it.
Amen. Yeah? Amen.
So sometimes you see the proof, yeah? But to come to my testimony, my wife was maybe 7 years before me a Christian. And I was truly looking for every reason to get her out of the church. So I actually started going there with the intention to say, no, that's brainwashed, I don't want you to go there anymore. But I just couldn't find anything wrong with it. Yeah? But I was still not believing. I had a good time around Christians, and I would help and everything, but I didn't. Until one night, I got extreme shoulder pain, as if someone had stuck a knife in there, and every minute would just twist it. And as a professional American football player, you have a different relationship to pain. You learn to deal with pain. You learn to go through pain. And, so after about 1 week, I went and bought some medicine, painkillers and things, and it just wouldn't work, and I was getting more aggressive towards my friends and family, and because of the pain was disturbing me. And so my wife said, go to doctor. My friend said, go to doctor. It's only a shoulder pain, it'll go away. And after 3.5 weeks, it was a Wednesday, and in Pattaya, the Mercy Center was the place where Wednesday pray team used to meet and pray before there was the office. And my wife used to go there. And I had not been able to sleep for about 3 weeks. And I was starting to breathe heavily, and I was aggressive, extremely aggressive, and on the way to the old Mercy Center, we would pass Bangkok Pattaya Hospital, and my wife while I took her to the prayer meeting, was crying and saying, please, please, let's stop there now. Let them have a look. And I said, I tell you what, if it doesn't go away by the weekend, on Monday I'll go to hospital. Okay? And she said, please, please, please. So we went past Bangkok Pattaya Hospital and came to the other side and went to Mercy Center. I dropped her off. And on the way back home, I still truly could not answer why. I know now, because I am a Christian. Something made me do a huge U-turn and go to Bangkok Pattaya Hospital. But at the time, I had no idea. Especially when I just passed it on the right way. And this was a huge U-turn. And I went there, and the reason I stand here today is only because of the grace of God.
Amen.
It is just unbelievable that you meet a doctor that says, no, I don't want to look at your shoulder. I want to x-ray your chest, because he felt that I was breathing a little bit heavy. And I said, no, shoulder pain. And he said, no, 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 please let me x-ray you. And he did. And he came back and said, your lungs are full with water. And there's two reasons for that. You either have pneumonia or you've had a heart attack. And I'm thinking, well, 44 is a little early for heart attack. So, can you punch something in here and let the water go out, and I'll go home and give me some tablets? No, 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 please. I have called the chef cardiologist, and I want him to take a look. And I said, well, you know what? I have to go pick up my mom now, so I can come back in about 2 hours. And then if you said, please, this is a serious matter, and I need you to, and then the cardiologist shows up. So I go in the room, now everybody's speaking Thai, there's 4 or 5 nurses and so on. And while I'm thinking how to tell my mom that I'm going to come late and so on, I see everybody's behavior change, especially when you know a little bit about body language. The speed in this small room just picked up, and the doctor just told me, we have to operate right now. And I could see from his face, and as it is in hospitals, the admin lady came in and she wanted to find out how much money I had with me, how could I pay for this. And the doctor physically pushed her out of the room. He said, get out! So then I understood, this is serious. Yeah? And so I had the operation, and while they were operating, their prayer team from the Encounter Church was praying for me.
Wow.
Because of my wife asking them to pray for me, for my situation. So when you think about it afterwards, the power of prayer, how much it helped me, the Holy Spirit that made me turn around and come there. Now this is the most incredible thing. After the operation, doctor showed me an x-ray of my heart. And my heart was only working at 26%.
Oh.
The rest was black. You could really see the black spot. And the senior surgeon, who was a senior surgeon at the hospital for 17 years, said he had never experienced somebody still walking alive at 26%. Generally, when your heart hits less than 50%, you die.
Yeah.
And he had said that he would have guaranteed within the next hour I would have died.
Wow.
So this was something so important to me that it made me actually think, because something very unusual. First of all, that God loved me so much.
Amen.
That kept me alive.
Amen.
Until I was intelligent enough to go to the hospital. At a heart rate of 26%, something that the senior surgeon said in 17 years he had never ever heard of such a thing. Then, I mean, it continues in a tremendous fashion. But the important thing was that it made me realize there is something, and there is a plan for me personally.
Amen.
Yeah?
Yeah.
And so, converted from a Muslim into Christianity, which is
Amen.
Normally very, very, very hard punishment. Yeah. But there was nothing, there was absolutely nothing that would have stopped me from becoming the person who I am.
Amen.
Yeah? Because even if you're a logical person, a clear thinking person, you know, normally you should not be, I shouldn't have been walking. 3.5 weeks after a heart attack, I finally got the immediate operation that I should have had 3.5 weeks ago. And with a heart that was working 26%, and no symptoms, only a shoulder pain.
Mm-hmm.
Normally there's a lot of symptoms, you know, that would, would show you, that you probably have a heart attack or something. And he hasn't forgotten me till this day. This doctor, every time he sees me, he shakes his head. Really?
Wow.
I don't know.
A miracle.
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
Amen.
There's no other way to describe it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's... So it was very easy after that, to be honest with you, for me to think about God and think about the reason my wife praying 7 years for me to become a Christian without actually, how shall I say, getting on my nerves or, you know, you should come. And I just felt like I was surrounded by good people.
Wow.
And I wanted, you know, I said, okay, and we had some event and I would help and prepare and do things, and I wasn't, you know, even a member of the congregation, if you like, but I did it because I felt I was in the right place. So I hope that will motivate some of you when you think about giving an altar call, that nothing is more authentic than your own stories.
Amen.
Nothing is, because you know it without a doubt from A to Z, and you know exactly what made you become. Yeah. And when you talk to somebody that is maybe in doubt or seeking or searching, just being authentic and telling them your own story is usually enough for them to think about it. And the first time that I was with a brother, and we had met somebody, and you know, he felt like he's going rough is treating him, that life is treating him rough, and he said something. He said, "I've tried everything. My friend, my fellow brother," he said, "no, you haven't. You haven't tried Christ."
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, wow, what a great way to come to the subject. And he said, "If you have really tried everything, then please try Christ. And I guarantee things will start to change for positive." And so there's so many opportunities that we need to have that sensibility to listen to somebody who's screaming for, "Please help me." Yeah? And we very often are very shy about what we say, how we say, I don't know. No, I'm in a, there's some really not nice looking people here, yeah? And they might, you know, make fun of me and what I say. Yeah? If you would have asked me 10 years ago that I would stand one day in front of a class of ministry and talk about God, I would have said, "I'll shoot you in the head." But here I am, and I'm doing this, and I do it with so much pleasure.
Amen.
Because it is such a great honor to serve Him.
Amen.
It really is.
Amen.
And this is another thing that you learn as you get to my age. You learn the true difference between some of the things, the values and the priorities that people, you know, I was successful, I was famous and all this, and I had a lot of money. And I bought with the age of 23 my first Porsche, you know, and everything's great. But now, sometimes riding a bicycle to work gives me much more pleasure than driving in an expensive car, or somebody giving me their car to drive, yeah? Just for this 1 or 2 hours that you have the pleasure to do that, you learn to appreciate things totally
Amen.
Different.
Amen.
Yeah? And when you put things in the right perspective, yeah? And each and every day, I am just grateful that I'm walking, talking, yeah? Because 6 years ago, yeah, different story.
Different.
So, thank you so much.
Amen.